I'm really delighted to be able to participate in this wonderful symposium. What I would like to tell you today is one particular aspect that is absolutely essential for normal brain development, and that is to have proper parenting. We've heard from the wonderful talk from BJ Casey right before me how important proper nurturing from caregivers is for a normal mental health of the infant that then become adult. And so the question we've been very interested in is, what makes a parent a parent? If you think about parenting involve one, two, sometimes multiple adults that take care of an infant, the relationship is completely asymmetrical. There is really a very helpless individual that requires a lot of care for a very, very long time. And so what makes parents be parents? It's, I think, a very interesting behavior, long-term behavior, that has a lot of emotional components. And so this is a behavior also that is displayed by many animal species. It is absolutely essential for the development of and the survival of the species. So the idea is that there might be some genetically pre-programmed neural circuit in the brain, and what we're interested in is really trying to understand the neural basis. What are the specific neurons that are involved in the control of parenting behavior, in the display of parenting behavior, and when is it that this behavior actually goes wrong? And there are a number of circumstances in which the behavior goes wrong. This is one of the most impressive or very surprising slide related to mental illness. That's the number of psychiatric hospitalization after childbirth. You can see right at the time of childbirth this enormous peak in psychiatric hospitalization of women. And these are patients that suffer from postpartum psychosis. This is quite rare. It requires hospitalization because these women have obsessive thought about harming their children, and therefore they require very intensive care. These way less severe form, which is postpartum depression, that affect 10 to 20% of mothers and 5 to 10% of fathers in the US, and these also come right after birth and result in an inability to emotionally connect with children and in effect impaired parenting. Now, there are quite a number of risk factors: stress, life circumstances, prior depression, and sensitivity to hormone changes. As it turns out, right at birth, there is an enormous change of hormonal levels in the young mother. You can see here progesterone, estrogen, oxytocin, prolactin. There is really an enormous and very sudden drop in hormone level. Some people call these hormonal cows, and women in particular that are sensitive to these hormone fluctuation have really difficulty in coping with those changes. So how do we understand the positive and the negative regulation of parental behavior? Well, let's turn to animals. So in animals and human as well, the primary caregiver is usually the mother. And in animals and in mammals in particular, this makes a lot of sense, because in mammals, the mother nurture the fetus, the embryo in utero for a long period of time, and then is involved in lactation. So really involve enormous maternal resources in nurturing the infant, and therefore it makes sense that mom continue to nurture the infant through parental behavior. What about males? Well, in most mammalian species, a very large subset of mammalian species, the males actually attack the infants, attack them sometimes or very often actually kill them. And this infanticidal behavior has been widely observed in many animal species. And it has been, it is thought that this is actually an evolutionary driven aggressive behavior of the males in order to gain access to the females that are not accessible when they are nurturing their own infant. And interestingly, this is a behavior that is absent in monogamous species in which both the male and the female are nurturing their infant, and therefore there is not this conflict of access of the male to the female. Now, infant neglect and aggression is also occasionally displayed by stressed female. This is seen in animals as well as I mentioned in postpartum depression and psychosis in humans. Now, we're not working with humans, we're not working with primates, we're working with mice. And in mice, there is, as in this animal species I mentioned, a very clear sexual dimorphism in behavior of animal, male and female, towards infants. Females, even virgin females, so sexually inexperienced female, spontaneously take care of infants. They will build a nest. They will lick and groom the pups, retrieve them to the nest, and huddle around the infants. Virgin males, in contrast, will spontaneously attack infants, wound them, and kill them through infanticidal behavior. So very, very different set of behavior. However, males are not always infanticidal. And in fact, strikingly, males after mating with a female are no longer infanticidal. And the video I would like to show you here is from, if you wish, a certified infanticidal male. This male attacked infants 3 weeks earlier. And then we had that male mating with a female. And then we are testing the behavior of this male now with these pups. And as you can see, the male has built a nest and now is retrieving these pups one by one. And I should mention, by the way, that these are not the pups of that particular male. This behavior will be displayed towards any infant that is to which they are exposed. So all the pups are now collected to the nest. And as you see, this is a really good dad. It's checking that it has not forgotten any pups. Okay, nobody left, good. Let's go back to the nest and then take care of the pups. So this is a really fascinating switch in behavior that really indicate that even in infanticidal males, there is the ability for these males to be parental. So how is this happening? Well, evolutionary speaking, this is actually not that surprising, because if you look at various animal species, insects, fish, amphibians, reptiles, birds and mammals, they are species in which the female is always the one handling the progeny. You can see little eggs here and little larvae over here. He's a tadpole on the back of that frog. But very similar species, genetically very similar, show animals in which there is biparental care. So both the male and the female handle the nurturing of the progeny. And similarly, also very similar species genetically have the male that exclusively takes care of the progeny. For example, this beetle here with the little eggs here, or this male amphibian with the tadpole, or here this fascinating monkey, the titi monkey, in which the male is actually providing exclusive care of the infant. So what's happening here? Well, in mice, what's happening is that there's a dominant male that mates with the female, and the female have a communal nest. This male is always parental. However, subordinate males that do not have access to the female are infanticidal, will tend to attack the male, kill the pups, and that in turn enable them to mate with the female, and at that time they become parental. Now, from a neuroscience standpoint, this is fascinating, because what it shows is that the brain has actually two types of circuit. One driving infanticidal behavior that is displayed by virgin males, and one that drives parental behavior that is displayed by females and fathers. So the question we are are very interested in is what are these neurons that control parenting and infanticidal behavior. And I would like to tell you today is how were we able to identify neurons that are necessary and sufficient to drive parenting behavior both in males and in females. And so what we use is a way to identify molecularly neurons that are active during a certain behavior. And the idea is that when a neuron is firing action potential, they are also changing their gene expression. And in particular, they turn on a particular gene, a transcription factor called CFOS. And so if we have a female or male interacting with pups, then the neurons that are involved in parenting will fire, and therefore they will express this gene CFOS. So if we look at the brain of parenting animal, both males and female, compared to infanticidal male, we find that there is a subpopulation of neurons in one particular area of the brain, in the hypothalamus, in an area called the medial preoptic area, in which you see this very dense collection of neurons that express this gene CFOS after the animal has interacted with pups, both males and females. So this is very interesting. It's actually not that surprising, because already in the 50s, 60s, 70s, a number of groups through lesion experiment have shown that maternal behavior requires the function of the medial preoptic area. But what we really would like to know is what precisely are the nature, the identity of these neurons that are CFOS positive. And in fact, this area, the medial preoptic area, fulfill a lot of function. It's involved in mating behavior, thermosensation, all sort of other functions than just parenting. So knowing precisely and specifically which are the neurons that express CFOS is something that we really need to know if we want to understand the control of parenting behavior. So we tested a number of candidate genes, and we found, to our delight, one particular gene, the gene that encodes for the neuropeptide galanine, as being very nicely co-expressed with CFOS when the animal are parenting. So interestingly, the number of galanine cells in the medial preoptic area is identical in males and females, in virgin males and in virgin male and mothers and fathers. In other words, these neurons are there in the male and the female brain, irrespective of whether these neurons are parenting or not. Now, galanine is a peptide expressed in many different areas. It has been involved in many different functions, such as nociception, sleep, thermoregulation, etc. So we don't know whether galanine has any role to play in parenting behavior. But the fact that we know one genetic marker gives us genetic tools. In other words, we are able to use a genetic line that expresses this enzyme called Cre, think about a scissor, if you wish, that enable to activate specific molecular tool to manipulate the activity of neurons. And so the experiment that we've done is to inject a conditional toxin into the preoptic area of a galanine Cre mouse. And what this does is that it enables us to kill specifically this galanine neuron present in the medial preoptic area. No other neurons outside of the brain or within the MPOA, nothing else than these specific galanine-expressing cells are affected. What's happening when we test the behavior of females and fathers when we kill galanine neurons in the medial preoptic area? The effect is very striking. The ablation of these MPOA galanine neurons entirely abolishes both maternal and paternal behavior and actually elicits infanticide. So there seems to be a role of these neurons not only in driving parenting behavior, but actually inhibiting infant-mediated aggression. Now we try the other experiment, a sufficiency experiment, which is if we now take an aggressive male and activate artificially galanine neurons in these infanticidal males, what's happening? What's happening, and we perform this experiment using a technique called optogenetics that enable to express a light-activated channel in the neurons and then using an optic fiber to activate these cells. And what we find when we shine light and activate these galanine neurons is that infanticidal males now are no longer infanticidal and instead display paternal behavior. So what this shows is that this specific population of of neurons are both necessary and sufficient for the control of parental behavior in both males and females. Now, parental behavior is a complex behavior, and what we'd like to do now is really to understand this behavior in mechanistic terms. So these neurons, as we've seen, are able to control parenting. Parenting means a lot of things: grooming, licking, crouching, retrieving, nest building, and then inhibiting infanticidal behavior. But these neurons do all of these according, obviously, to the presence of an infant, but also according to the physiological state. Male, for example, will either trigger this behavior or not trigger this behavior according to whether they are fathers or not. And so what we would like to understand is, how are all these different displays being performed, and what is the role of this environment in the activity of these neurons? And the first set of experiments that we've done is really try to understand whether these galenic neurons really are involved in all these different part of parenting. And so the experiment that I'm going to show you here is what is called bulk imaging or volume imaging of these galenic neurons. The idea is that these neurons now are expressing a genetically encoded indicator of neuronal activity. So these neurons are now going to emit fluorescence when they are active, and only in this particular area. And what we're going to have, we have an optic probe that enable to visualize the entire intensity of the signal. And so it's called bulk imaging because we don't have cellular resolution. In other words, we're looking at the activity of all these neurons together. And so what you see here is a female, and here a bunch of pups over there. And the animal has an optic fiber here, and what you can see here is the level of calcium. And as the female approaches the pups, you can see the level of calcium going up. And she's licking the pups, and indeed the level of calcium stays high. And then as she brings the pup to the nest and start licking the pup, then the level of calcium is really going up the roof. Interestingly, we found that all the parts composing parental behavior involve these galenic neurons. So that's quite interesting. Now, I'm going to show you another video in which this female here has a very similar type of behavior, as you can see. She's grooming something, licking, and then she's going to bring that that thing to the nest, exactly as she has done with the pups. But as you can see here, the level of signal is completely flat. What's happening? Well, although the behavior looks very much like parenting behavior, actually, she's handling a fish cracker. So that's not the pup. And in these circumstances, galenic neurons are totally silent. So again, although the behavior looks exactly the same, what's happening in the brain, the significance of this behavior is completely different and involves very different parts of the brain. So in summary, we started by the idea that parenting is an essential behavior, and that in different species it's displayed differently by males, by females, sometimes both, and that we were really interested in going to the cellular and molecular basis of this behavior. And we found this really interesting system in a mouse in which animals are or are not parenting, and we found this fascinating neuronal cell type, these MPOA galenic neurons, that now really give us entry into how parenting behavior is controlled. What are the different regulation of these neurons? What are their sets of projection? What type of input do they receive? And how all of these changes in both during development, in males, in females, and during mental illness. And I would like to thank the people, the wonderful collaborator in my lab who've performed this work. Thank you. Thank you.